So we know now that we can sort of analyze different mixtures of substances through chromatography by running standards. So that means running if we suspect that a certain chemical substance is contained in a sample of food or drink, then we can run a standard chromatogram where we run a chromatogram of just that substance and the mixture to be tested, and we can see if that substance is likely to be contained in the mixture. Now, another way to see if a certain or see or identify if a certain substance is contained in a mixture is to use RF values. Now, an RF value is basically a value that we attach to sort of one spot or one component that we obtain from a chromatogram. So, for example, if we look at this red spot here, we can calculate its RF value or retardation factor, which is what RF stands for. We can calculate its retardation factor by dividing the distance of the red spot from the origin, of the solvent front from the origin. So what that means is, if for example we say that in this chromatogram here, I've put this purple spot of some sort of solution on the origin here. I've let the chromatogram run, and I've got a red spot here, and we'll say that this distance here. So that distance there comes out to be 3 centimeters. Now, if we look at the solvent front, then we look at this distance here. That's the distance of the solvent from the origin of the solvent front, and we say that this distance might be 5 centimeters. So in this case, if you want to calculate the retardation factor for the red spot or the components or the component of the mixture that formed the red spot, then the retardation factor is going to be meters, 3/5, or 0.6. Now the units aren't really significant here as long as we use the same unit on the top and the bottom of this fraction here. So as long as we measure one distance in centimeters and the other in centimeters, or maybe both in meters or millimeters or whatever, then we'll get the right answer here. So here we've shown that the retardation factor for this red spot is 0.6. Now, what this retardation factor value allows us to do, it allows us to check if, a certain chemical compound or chemical substance is contained in a mixture without having to run an adjacent standard like this. So we know that, say we were testing to see if this purple mixture contained, a certain type of vitamin, maybe vitamin A, for example, over here. Then what we could do is we could spot vitamin A here. We could do a dot of vitamin A here before we ran this spot, the same color and distance away from the origin as one of these spots here. And now if these spots lined up, say we spotted some pure vitamin A here and it formed a red spot there, then that would tell us that this red spot in this juice or this food here is likely to be caused by vitamin A if we have two red spots the same distance. However, what RF values allow us to do is they allow us to check if something like vitamin A is contained in this sample without having to run a standard. So we know that when we were running standards, they had to be run on the same chromatogram to see if they ran the same distance up the piece of paper or the piece of cardboard. And the reason we had to do them on the same chromatogram is because the distance that they ran up the piece of paper would be affected by how far the solvent front traveled. So, for example, if we did another chromatogram here, and we only let the solvent front go up to maybe here, maybe about halfway. And then this red spot would still be formed at probably the same RF value, or definitely at the same RF value. So the distance of the red spot from the origin along here, divided by the distance of the solvent front from the origin, would still equal 0.6. However, if we line these up side by side, we're not going to be able to directly see if the red spots travel the same distance. So we're not going to be able to use a standard unless we have the standard on the same chromatogram. However, what the retardation factor allows us to do is it allows us to basically check if a substance is contained in a mixture without running a standard on the same chromatogram. Because what we're doing is we're considering or we're taking into account the distance that the solvent front has. Therefore, that allows us to, that sort of removes any problems that are going to be caused by running a separate chromatogram where the solvent front travels a different distance. Now, we can see that if this is the formula for the retardation factor, then we can see that if we're calculating an RF value, it's always going to be less than one. So basically, we should never have a component of a chromatogram going as far or further than the solvent front, And so for that reason, our RF value should always be less than 1. Now, we can also look at RF values in terms of the affinity of a component of a mixture for the stationary phase and for the mobile phase. So if we think about it, if we have a substance that is most absorbed, so that means it likes to stick to the paper a lot. If we're doing paper chromatography, it likes to stick to the paper rather than dissolve in the water. So if we've got a substance that's most adsorbent to the stationary phase, then that means it's going to travel the smallest distance. It's not going to let the water carry it up the chromatogram very far. So if we have something that's the most absorbent to the stationary phase, then that means it's not going to go very far, and it's going to have the lowest RF value, because the distance of the component from the origin is going to be very small, because this kind of want to adsorb onto the stationary phase is going to prevent it from traveling very far up the chromatogram. In the same way, we can say that it most likes to be desorbed into the mobile phase. That means it's going to travel a long way. It's going to be dissolved in the solution a lot, and so thus it's going to make a long way up the chromatogram, and that means it's going to have a high RF. So we can kind of compare and analyze and sort of look at the similarities between RF values and thus figure out whether or not components like to adsorb onto the stationary phase or desorb into the mobile phase. Now, when we're doing RF values, as I said, it means we don't have to run standards. And what it means is that we can compare the RF values that we get for components of a mixture to maybe some values that we're already given. So maybe we can look up some data somewhere saying that, yes, you know, this vitamin A, under certain conditions will have a given RF value. Now, what matters is the conditions. So we can compare RF values that we obtain on our own experimentally with sort of wider published RF values for different substances. However, it's important to realize that these RF values are going to change under different conditions. So we might be able to look up the known figures for RF values at, you know, a given temperature with a given stationary phase and a given solvent. And, you know, maybe a given atmospheric sort of makeup, you know, if the air is different somewhere, it's going to affect the way the chromatogram runs. And so these are sort of four of the conditions that can affect the retardation factor of a component of a mixture. And so what we can do is if we run this chromatogram, you know, at a certain temperature with a certain stationary phase, a certain solvent, you know, with just regular atmosphere or with a certain type of with air surrounding it, then what we can do is we can look up the known RF values for, you know, different vitamins under that same temperature, same stationary phase, with the same solvent and in the same atmosphere. So we can compare the retardation factors for, you know, different vitamins or whatever we're looking for in given conditions, as long as we run our own chromatogram under those same conditions. So let's say here we've done this chromatogram here. As I said earlier, the red spot is 3 centimeters from the origin, and the solvent front is 5 centimeters from the origin. And let's say that we measure the blue spot as well. It comes out to be 4 centimeters from the origin. The mixing factor of the blue spot as well, and that's going to be 4/5 or 0.8. So now let's say, you know, we've measured the temperature. We've used a specific stationary phase, specific solvent. Then what we can do is we can maybe go on the internet or find a textbook somewhere and say, find a table here of different vitamins and their retardation factors at the same temperature, stationary phase, and solvent that we used here. And so if I looked it up, I ran this chromatogram, got these figures here, and then looked up this table here, which told me that vitamins A, B, and C have these retardation factors at the temperature that I ran my chromatogram at and with the same stationary phase and solvent that I used on my own chromatogram. And so what I can do as a result of that is check to see whether either of these components are caused here. So what we can do is we can say this red spot had a retardation factor of 0.6. So we look over at our table and we look for an RF value over here that's close to 0.6. Now we see here that vitamin A has an RF value of 0.62, which is quite close to 0.6. And due to, you know, the often rough nature of especially sort of paper chromatography, where it's very hard to measure an exact value, we can say that are, although they're slightly off, the RF values for vitamin A and for the red component here, although they're slightly off, we can say with a fair amount of certainty that the red spot is caused by vitamin A. Similarly, if we look at the blue spot, we've got 0.8 here, we can look at this list again and say, oh, okay, vitamin B has an RF value of 0.79 under these conditions. So we can say with a fair degree of certainty that the blue dot is caused by vitamin B. Now I say that we can, that's assuming that we're sort of already expecting these vitamins maybe to be in the mixture. And so often chromatography, when we're analyzing what the components are in a mixture, is all about having, already a predetermined idea of what might be in there. And that way we know what to look for and what to compare it to, what RF values to compare these components here to, sort of what data to look for in order to figure out what components are in this mixture here. So that's how we go about determining what components might be in a mixture or a solution, this purple solution here, using RF values. So it's all about ensuring that we run our chromatogram under the same conditions as the data that we're provided, and that way we can compare RF values. One other important thing to remember when we're running chromatograms is that, in a lot of cases when we're dealing with food, these dots on the chromatogram are going to be colorful and visible to the naked eye. Now it's important also to be aware that in a lot of cases these pigments will not be visible. So when we're calculating the RF value, what we will sometimes need to do is something like we might have to shine UV on a chromatogram, and that will allow us to see more spots. Some components when they're sort of dissolved onto the adsorbed onto the surface of the paper, they will fluoresce only under UV light, otherwise they won't be visible. And so shining UV light can allow us to see some new spots on a chromatogram that we may not have been aware of. And similarly, if we maybe spray the chromatogram with some chemicals, with certain types of chemicals may react with these chemicals may react with the diff with different spots on a chromatogram to form a new colored compound. And so sometimes with chemicals in order to see some extra spots that weren't previously visible to the naked eye on our chromatogram. So that's just something else that we should be aware of when we're talking about sort of paper and thin layout chromatography. So that's how we do RF values. That's how we use them with our previously obtained data to check to see if certain components of a mixture are in fact present.